So personally, I love the quote from Steve Jobs where he said, you know, he was at the Stanford commencement of speech and he was talking about how you can't always plan your life, how your life is going to go. And that typically you don't sit down and go, oh, I want to do this and then this and then this and this. Typically you kind of go on this like winding path and then you look back and you're like, well, all those different things connected. So I think kind of in that light, Austin, I want to ask you your story and have you walk us through your story. But instead of starting at the start, I want to start at the end where we're at now and kind of go backwards. So on that note, before we jump in, why don't you just kind of give a little overview? You know, right now we're recording this in March of 2021. And where are you at right now with Strides? What kind of projects are you working on? What are some of the goals that you have right now? And what are you hoping to accomplish, you know, maybe in the next 6 months or so with Strides?
For those of you that don't know what Strides is it's a development company that really focuses on communication, right? And to kind of just really quickly get into the background of what Strides is and what we stand for, there are a lot of development companies or development teams that you can end up working with. But what ends up happening is your product eventually starts to lose alignment with your overall vision. And one thing I really take pride in is my ability to communicate with other people. And so what we did is we started my company called Strides Development to help really bridge that gap. And so I would say like our big goal for 2021 is just to make sure that we're hitting everybody's mark, right? So, I mean, from like a business standpoint, obviously, you know, we want to increase revenue, but I think the two big goals is to make sure that with all of our clients, we're just nailing it right on the head with our vision. And then I would say the second big thing is to really just make sure that we can put more content out there for founders, different entrepreneurs, just so that we can make sure that everybody has the, you know, same opportunity to hit the mark. I think there's a huge gap in information out there currently. And so I just want to fill the market with more information just to make sure, you know, everybody can be successful, or at least everybody has a good shot. Because a lot of these founders, a lot of these people we're working with, they don't have the technical background, the technical experience, or really the past experience to really be driving this as hard as they can be. So if we can put content out and really just help founders keep their development team in alignment with their overall goals, I think, you know, as a company, we can really crush it. So that's what Strides is up to.
Yeah, I feel like you and I have had a lot of different discussions and we get on the phone with many different founders. And a lot of these founders are just kind of shell-shocked at what the development process is going to look like, maybe even timeframes and overall cost. And so that's where we have found that there's this huge disconnect and a black box on how to really start to build an app. Also, I mean, how many countless conversations have we had just be like, how do we educate everybody? How do we let people know what it takes to do these steps? And so that's really kind of what led us to these podcasts and building this content, because we really want to help bridge that gap. Because we've looked, Shane, you've looked, Austin, we've all looked. There's not a lot of information out there. And so we want to help bridge that gap when it comes to understanding what it takes to actually move forward with this incredible idea that our founders have.
So I'm really interested in that, because I personally think that a lot of what makes somebody who they are in their role is their background, right? And so like, they always kind of say if a CEO has a finance background, he's going to be a different kind of leader than if he has a product development background or, you know, that kind of thing. So why don't we go back through your story a little bit, Austin, because I'm curious where you came up with that approach, because I think that is something that really makes you guys stand apart is you obviously have the technical skills, or I guess I should say something that makes us stand apart, right? Like Strides has the technical skills, and Austin, you're a very technical person, but you know, I've seen you talk to clients about their projects and it's never, you know, you're never nerding out on what language it's written in and things like that. You're a lot more, are we solving a problem and what's the big goal of it? You know, so where did you kind of learn that? Like maybe back up a little bit to when you, let's actually kind of go. So now we have the end of your story. Let's go kind of to the middle a little bit and let's talk about when you first started developing apps. I think it was right after you finished selling door to door, right? Which we can get into, but what brought you into developing apps? And then how long was it before you noticed that just simply writing code for a client or for an app wasn't going to get them across the finish line?
So I would say where I started development and where I really started to see that gap was back in college. So I was attending school at Idaho State University. You know, I was in a room with a bunch of people in computer science. I was also in a room with a bunch of people who were supposedly going for business. So all of my classes were business and computer science. And so it's a specialized degree called business informatics. And so I got a little bit of both worlds. And as I was there, the one thing I noticed is nobody had the drive to really, you know, do something cool. They just wanted to get that A or whatever. But at least in computer science, the thing that I noticed is people really struggled with conversation. And so that's probably where the earliest I noticed that like there is like this gap, like these developers live in this bubble. And it's super funny. Even our teachers would be like, they would call like customers. What do they call them? It was like super funny, but customers were like, it was literally like a saying, like, never talk to the customers. They're the fuzzy people. We don't talk to them. And it's just like, it's just super weird because if you talk to anybody, it's like, you've got to know who your customer is before you can actually like solve a problem. And so that was super funny. And so as I continued through this path of tech, I went to this coding boot camp in Utah. And so there's a big difference in culture between Idaho and Utah. Idaho, everybody cares about agriculture. Then there is Utah, which is, I would say, a bunch of people who are really looking to level up. And so as I went to this coding boot camp, I saw that people were definitely like more gung-ho to try and solve a problem, but again, didn't necessarily have the communication skills or the sales skills to really dive deep and figure out what the person is really saying. And that's something that I learned doing sales. So it's not even that like I spent 2 or 3 years doing sales, but my whole life was literally doing sales. It was figuring out what got people to tick. It was really just diving in and finding out what like a key problem was. And then from there, taking, you know, the conversation or the direction where it needed to go to find out, you know, the root problem.
So then how did that work in college for you? Because I know, for myself personally, you know, a lot of times you get into college and it's like, oh, it's not really my, or you get into a certain thing and you're like, oh, you know, I had one expectation and this didn't turn out the way that I was thinking. So how did that turn out? I mean, did you go start a business with anybody from college? Did you finish college? Did you finish school? What happened with you and your college?
So I actually didn't end up finishing school. So I guess it was kind of a weird path. So, I mean, just kind of like you went to my first year, did all like the computer science classes, the general like accounting, whatever. Went through this first year and was like, man, this really just isn't me. And these people just don't understand me. And so I moved to Utah, went to boot camp, learned iOS development. And then for about 4 months, I just did iOS development, you know, just in Utah, just did a bunch of freelancing stuff. And then I was thinking, well, maybe I should go back and get my degree. Maybe now that I have like this different perspective on development, that going back to school would be a little bit easier, right? And so I actually ended up going back to Idaho State University. And this is probably where I noticed that big gap in communication. So now I had not only, I would say, like a fundamental understanding of what computer science is or business informatics is. And then I also had, like, I would say, the software development expertise. Now I had like the understanding of all of these computer science concepts from going to Dev Mountain. So going back to school, like I would say, yes, classes were easier, but I actually realized that I was now even farther apart than the people that I was attending school with. It was just super weird. It's like going from Utah culture of everybody's, you know, trying to solve a problem. Everybody's like really trying to level up to back to school where everybody's just super content with life. On top of now, like the programming skills that I have, now I just really wanted to build shit. And I couldn't, nobody, like it was funny, like I'd go to people, hey, does anybody want to build this? Like, what are you guys working on? Blah, 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 blah. And everybody's just like, oh yeah, I'm not doing anything. I don't know, I work at like McDonald's and I don't know, play video games. And it's just like, this is not me. And it's so weird because I'm such a nerd, but I just like don't care for video games. I definitely didn't care for homework. It was just a different thing. And so coming back out to Utah, I lived in Logan for a long time and just did a ton of freelance work. I eventually ended up getting my first full-time gig managing a team of developers. It's super weird. Like I went from like, I would say like average experience, development experience to like running this entire team, having to hit deadlines, having to build like roadmaps for people. So it was definitely like a step up in my career. That's when I saw a lot of the problems. So it's super crazy. A lot of development shops, what they'll do is they'll be like, hey, client, whoever you are, what's your idea? Take this idea, and then just ship it overseas to build it out. And two things that ended up happening, well, two real big mistakes. One, a lot of the time the development shops don't have a true understanding of the problem you're trying to solve, or really don't get in the weeds with you. They just care about, you know, solving the problem. And then you take that lack of understanding and then ship it overseas, there's an even bigger understanding of what should be done. And that's probably like a whole nother conversation too. But long story short, managed this team overseas and hated it. It was just so much work. Like, it was a lot of work to relay the information from the client to the team overseas, as well as hitting deadlines. Like, my schedule was, you know, 9 o'clock, get on a meeting with them, stay up till 12, make sure I answer any questions, go to bed, see everything they wrote, everything that was done, and just like wanting to tear my hair out because I'd have to go and like fix a bunch of things just because it's just a very different cultural experience.
So I have a couple background questions going into that. So you grew up in Idaho. Now I'm not putting myself there, but like you said, a lot of agriculture, a lot of, you know, maybe there was this kind of this feeling of, I want to get out of here a little bit, right? Just based on your interests and things like that. And then you go to school, and it seems like the typical view would be, oh man, school is going to be my ticket out. I'm going to get a really good job. I'm going to, you know, grind the corporate ladder for 10 years. You obviously did not do that. Like, you didn't take that path at all. Is there any part of you that's like, wait, maybe I'm the idiot here? You know, like instead of looking at everybody else and saying, oh, this isn't for me, was there any part of you that was like, wait, what's wrong with me? Why am I not feeling like I fit into this mold?
I think there are two parts to that. So I feel like the first question is like, was it hard, or like what challenges were there when deciding to leave school? So I want to hit on that a little bit. And for me, I would say it was hard, and for the typical reasons, right? Like, you have, you know, your partner, or at this point, I had a girlfriend at the time. She was like, oh yeah, keep going to school, finish, like you're almost there, yada, yada, yada. And then you've also got the family side of things. Like, I mean, believe it or not, like when you're, you know, 19 to 22, 25 years old, at least, I mean, you have that really strong bond with your family and you feel like you should listen to what they say. And it was hard, but then I just got to like a fuck you point. Like, I just like hated it. I just knew at my core that like school was trash. Like, there was zero reason to do it. I already had experience. And for me, it was just like, no, like, I'm just not going to school. And what was even worse is like, I had the perfect opportunity. Whole thing was paid for. I was making like 10 grand a semester at school. And I was getting paid to go to school and still did not want to go to school just because the people I was with. I would rather pay $100,000 a semester at a school being around like a bunch of people like actually solving problems than get paid to sit there and be this robot. That was the first thing. Like, it was a challenge to get over like the family, you know, everybody like go to school, just get the degree. That was hard, but I am so much happier now. And I would say have become quote unquote like more successful because of the choice I made. Then there's like the other part to that. It's like, the question is like, how do you know that, you know, you shouldn't be going to school? Like, 100%, when you wake up and you're just not happy, like something in your life is wrong. And literally every single day I was like borderline depression. Like, I didn't want to go to school. I wanted to lay in bed all day. I didn't want to do homework. And it's super funny because it's like, I don't know, everybody in that situation is typically like, oh no, like, you're good. Like, everybody hates school. But no, like, it fucking sucked. Like, when you hate your life, change something. Don't just be content. again, it was just really like a fuck everybody moment.
It's funny. I feel like there's a lot of advice that's just like, yeah, life is hard. Things are tough. People aren't happy. Yeah. You know, make habits, work out, do all this kind of stuff. And it's like, at a core level, you know, you can do all the meditating, all the working out, all the eating right. But if your life is headed in a direction you want it to be heading, you're miserable. You know, it's like, it's the worst part of your day.
Well, one thing I can attest to Austin is he doesn't sit around and wait for things to happen. And that's something I've noticed is like, he's the type of person that's like, listen, if I want something, if I'm not happy or if there's something that needs to be done, I'm going to go out and do it. And that's something that I've actually admired about Austin. Even, I mean, we've known each other for quite a few years, and I knew him when he was just this young kid right out of high school selling door to door. But like, that kid was just like set, like, no, I want to go make more money, so I'm going to do more work. And I can see Austin sitting in this college dorm or wherever saying, dude, I'm not happy. This is stupid. I'm sick of chasing a grade and I want to do something with my life. And he's like, F it, I'm out of here. And so like, he just bounces because that's just Austin and that's how he is. And like, literally, that's why he's seen such a huge amount of successes, because like, listen, if you're in a situation where you're not happy, do something. Action. Go. Yeah. Don't just wait for it to come, because it won't.
Well, it was just super funny. I was just talking to a buddy the other day, and this is when I just got to Utah. So I just went to Utah, got a super cheap place, lived with a buddy over in Logan. Anybody who knows Logan, Utah, super small town, kind of fun, but moved in with this guy. And I start talking, like I would say I'm like a big talker. Like I'd like to tell people like what I'm doing, like what's going on. I like to know about what they're doing. And it was super funny because I was like, initially, like I was playing with this idea of, you know, starting this company, and we were talking, and basically I was just telling him, you know, what I wanted to accomplish. And I was on the phone with him the other day, and he was like, dude, it was crazy. Like I was thinking back to all those conversations we had. And at first I was like, dude, there's like this, you know, young guy in my house with all these ideas who has no fucking clue what the real world is. And he called me yesterday and he was like, dude, it's so crazy looking back on that and then seeing how far you've come. You're just not a person that waits. You just get it done. And it's just kind of interesting. Like, it's definitely like perspective. Like if you want something, like it's really not that hard. You just got to go do it, right?
So that's kind of my next question, actually. So I feel like now we know where you're at now. We have kind of this middle, you know, this pivotal, you know, you kind of left college and started on your, you know, your trajectory. We still have a few pieces to fill in, but where did you learn that? Like, let's kind of go back. I think it'd be fun to walk through, you know, kind of your story and your family and how you were as a kid, because I think you obviously learned that or you unlearned that at some point. Like even me, I think I'm a pretty go-getter kind of person, but typically I'm like kind of waiting for permission, right? I'm, if I was in your shoes, I might be like, hey, I want to leave school. I'm thinking about da 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 da. And then it's typically for me, it's like, you know, a mentor goes, oh, well, you should go do this. And almost, you know, almost gives me the permission to be like, oh yeah, that's right, I can go do that. You know, you seem very like, you're very self-directed and you don't really need like an outside mentor. You're almost your own mentor. Where did that come from? How did you learn that? And what was your childhood like that kind of brought you to a point where you were just like, hey, if I want to do something, I'm going to do it. I'm going to go and make it happen.
Yeah. So when you grow up, you typically have your mom, your dad, your couple siblings, and just a ton of people to lean on. So for example, let's say you got, you know, it's you and your brother, and you guys are going to go do something crazy. It typically goes along the lines of, you know, hitting them on the shoulder, being like, hey, let's go do this. And they'll be like, no. And you'll like convince them, like, dude, let's go do this. Let's go freaking like egg this guy's house, like whatever. And eventually he gets on board and you both go together and you do it. And that's where like at a really young age, you start to really like seek that permission. You don't want to do it yourself. You got to lean on, you know, mom, dad, your siblings to come do stuff with you. And the unfortunate thing is I didn't really have that. I didn't have not necessarily like the parents, but I didn't have the environment to where I always had to ask permission. I grew up, I was put in foster care, you know, at 8 years old. Got adopted when I was 12, and between the ages of probably like 6 and 12 years old, I really didn't have anybody. Like I was constantly shifting homes, getting new, not only was I going to different schools, but I was straight up like given new families. Like every year it was a new family that I would have to like embed myself into. It was a new school that I had to embed myself into. And eventually you just start learning that like, if you start to depend on other people, you're really not going to go anywhere. And I mean, there's like two sides of that story. Like with business, like number one thing to do is to find people that compliment you. But in all reality, if you can't yourself just get stuff done, you're going to struggle. And that's where I saw it. Having to, you know, lean on friends, having to lean on parents, I eventually started to view them as unreliable. And altogether, I just completely cut them out. Like I didn't care. I didn't care about their opinions. I didn't care what they wanted. 100% it was me. And it was like this, initially it was this selfish thing. It was like, I'm only going to do what's right for me. Screw you. Like, it doesn't matter. Like, I'm just going to do what's good for me. And then eventually transitioned to, okay, actually, like, I'm not just going to do good for me. I'm going to do good for family. So now we get to this stage of, I'm 12 years old. I was adopted. And that's when I got smacked in the face. for two reasons. One, I was adopted into a huge family. So 23 brothers and sisters. I'm pretty sure my parents are still adopting. It's kind of sad. I probably don't even know. Like every time I go home, there's like more siblings. I'm pretty sure like my oldest brother right now is probably like 40 years old. My youngest sibling, we're probably like as of right now, probably in the 7 to 8 range. And so I would say at this point, I'm probably lower middle. And so I also had the opportunity to get beat up on, right? So one thing that you typically happens at a super young age is you've got your brothers and sisters, and I mean, they kick your butt in a lot of things. Like you learn to like wrestle, do all these things, and they beat you up. And I didn't have that until I was 12 years old. But when you're 12 years old, messing with, you know, 15, 16 year olds, they kind of just kick the shit out of you. And so what ended up happening is I was finally like entered, like pushed into what I would call like a normal upbringing, but not so normal because it was 23 brothers and sisters. A lot of them had severe disabilities. And so not only was I put into like a normal, or what I would call like a normal environment, but I also had responsibility put on me when I was a kid too. And for a long time, my mom pushed, hey, go be a kid, go outside, go do these things. And I already missed that. Like I had become like an independent person. I knew exactly what I wanted. I wanted to be working at a young age. Like I wanted to be self-sufficient, like whatever. But eventually, as I started to get closer with my siblings, I started to learn like different tips and tricks. So I've got a sister, her name is Zoe. She's blind. She only has one arm that works. Amazing pianist, by the way. She makes Mozart look like a child. She
with one hand?
Hated, yeah, so it's super funny. She actually, so she'll do her bottom hand with her left hand, and she'll do the top hand with her nose and tongue. So she, and she'll do it on the fly. So she'll listen to a brand new song and just start playing stuff. Super crazy, like super talented, but she was stubborn. She's probably one of the most stubborn siblings that I had, but I learned so much, right? She didn't want, like when my parents left, she didn't want to take her meds. She didn't want to eat food. She didn't want to do all these things. And so eventually I learned how to like really like understand people there. Cause I mean, I would have to persuade at a young age to do things for the better of other people, right? Versus doing things that were better for me. Long story short, I was put into this situation where I was given, I would say, an extra amount of responsibility, but I was able to also take the skills I had learned previously and apply them in an effective and what I would call like decent way. At that point, literally as soon as I graduated from high school, I moved out and I've never lived with my parents since. It's kind of crazy. I just kind of became my own little butterfly and traveled the world. So,
was there anything inside of you that had, you know, because I'm always really interested with where people feel like they have like kind of their blocks of they, you know, they say, oh, I grew up like this, or I grew up on, you know, this side of the tracks, or I grew up, you know, my parents did this kind of work, so I need to kind of do that. Was there anything inside of you that kind of said, wait, you know, who am I to be successful, or who am I to like have these big ambitions, or, you know, I'm a, you know, a foster kid from, you know, rural Idaho. Was there anything inside you that was, that ever felt that, or did you feel that and you push those feelings down? Did they never even come up? Did you have to overcome those, or how did you kind of break out of that, you know, that mental, cause there's kind of these mental like guideposts you almost have to break through if you're going to get out of a situation mm-hmm. like that. When I hear your, and your full story, right? Like I've heard the hour version of your childhood story. It just blows my mind, you know?
Yeah. And so I really think the question is did you ever have any doubt? And then how did you overcome that doubt at the end of the day? And I mean, when you grow up in a small town like Shelley, I mean, you see success, but I would say the small scale success. Obviously there are probably tons of people who have become successful. And maybe I just don't know them or don't care for them. I mean, like anybody else, I was that same kid in high school who was like, oh yeah, I'm going to be a millionaire at 25, right? Or I'm going to have like a couple companies and I'm going to have like this success. And everybody around is like, oh, you're full of crap, like blah, blah, blah. You're going to go to school. You're going to do this. And it's like, no, I'm actually not. And it's super funny. And they're like, why do you think you're any different? And I think the big thing is I've seen what a lot of people haven't seen. Like I've literally seen the good, the bad, and the ugly at a really young age. And for me, it was super easy to be like, no, like you really have no idea what the world's like. I'm really like this old guy in this young body is really what it came down to. I mean, yeah, there were like the naysayers of, oh, you're not going to make it. Even the teachers, it was super funny. This is how much like I hated small town people. I would literally play Clash of Clans 4 hours a day. I literally did that all through high school. And literally every single teacher was like, dude, you're going to amount to nothing. And it's super funny. They're like, you're not going to accomplish anything. You're basically going to be this bum. Like, you need to actually put in the work, like, blah, 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 blah. And literally the whole time I'm just like, dude, you have no idea. Like, high school, college literally means nothing. Just because, like, 100% I'm more motivated than you, so I'm just going to accomplish what I want at the end of the day.
Yeah, what the teacher's really saying is, you're not going about life in the way that I think you should do it, and so I personally can't see how you would be successful from my point of view, but it's like, they don't know that you have your entirely different point of view, you know?
Yeah, well, and it's funny. Yeah. Like, teacher's like a whole thing, but even like my weights coach, and this is funny because I was actually talking to my buddy about this the other day. My weights coach was very much like, you need to be doing this workout. You need to be doing X, Y, Z things. And it was in a very negative way. Like, this is why you're not a state champion. You're not going to win state because of this. You're going to accomplish nothing. You would have won that match if you did this. And it's like, I eventually got to this point of, again, like, I'm a fuck you kind of person. And I would opt into his classes. I literally do nothing. So I would take the bad grade. And then I would wake up at like 5 a.m. and go to the gym or like work out twice a day just so that he could watch me do nothing and continue to tell me I'm a piece of crap. I just kind of fed into it and then put in the work outside, right?
Well, but it's funny because you're very deliberate. I'd say you're very specific. I'd say, you know what you want and you're not really going to like kind of play the typical, you know, kind of the, like, that's actually what I love about working with you. It's not the typical like kind of politics where, you know, you're afraid of hurting my feelings or, but, you know, it's, you'll say, no, I don't like that, you know? And so it actually, I think it allows us to get to things done a lot faster. But I've also seen how you care about people and, you know, like the story with your sister, it's so cool. You know, it's cool. I think the way you described it to me is you said, you know, at first I was, you know, selfish to try to, or you kind of said it here, right? Like I was selfish to get my own things done. And then I realized that I could be selfish to actually help other people. And it's like, and that's what I've seen you do for, you know, Stride's clients and the Stride's team, like over and over. I think it's pretty cool. So you definitely use that skill in a good, you know, you use it for good, not for evil, you know, which is cool.
So I have a question. So one thing I've learned about Austin is Austin also is probably one of the most logical people I've ever met in my life. Literally, like, if you can bring logic to a conversation with Austin, regardless if he likes it or not, he usually goes with like what makes sense. And I'm curious, Austin, like, how does your brain work that way? Because there seems to be a lot of emotion, right? And you have like this F you attitude, like, I don't care, I'm going to do what I want. But how can you still be so logical and compassionate at the same time?
So honestly, for a long time, I didn't used to be that way. So to kind of throw in here, I don't know if any of you have seen like Vampire Diaries or anything, but there's a...
I missed that one.
Okay, so... Yeah, my bad. I didn't know. So if you haven't watched Vampire Diaries, huge disclaimer, you totally should. But there's... I don't even remember this guy's name. I think it's Stefan. And there's this concept of like this emotional switch, right? And he can literally turn his emotion like on and off. And it's super weird that I would compare myself to this. But literally there comes a point where like you hit life like at its lowest of low. So like at some point, like it's hard. When you come to the realization that, you know, your biological mother or your biological father just like didn't care and didn't want you, or that people in your life just like weren't trying, at first it becomes like this super emotional thing. Like, people don't care. People aren't trying. Like, nobody loves me. Like, literally, I have nothing. I don't have a family. I don't have money. I don't have friends. I don't have support. I'm literally, like, in this world all by myself. And what happens is you eventually stop caring. Like, 100%. Like, you get to this point where you don't give a flying F about anyone, including yourself, right? And what happened was, is I had gone through such an emotional roller coaster between the ages of probably like 6 and 10 years old. I would say that I didn't live like a stable life until I was about 10. And so between 6 to 10 years old, it was this huge like emotional battle. And it was 100% of things I couldn't control. But because of that, after you have cried yourself to sleep so many times, you eventually run out of tears, sort of concept, right? Mm-hmm. And so legit, like you run out of tears, you stop caring, and 100% like emotion is completely taken out of the picture. It's like 100% like, what can I do to better myself? Like I'm pretty sure there's probably some crazy statistic of people who go into foster care and come out and either become like end up in jail, end up on the streets. There's probably a very slim like success percentage, and 100% of that is based on perspective. So I was a person of like, I don't know, giving up just like didn't make sense to me. And so instead it was like, take emotion out of the entire thing. It's like, what things can I put in front of myself to make myself happier and successful? And 100%, that's like where critical thinking started to come into play.
Yeah.
The one thing that was consistent was math and music. And those are the two things I had. And so I really think that's what built into my character of like critical and logical thinking. So
that's interesting. I remember I saw something on Instagram one time that was like the saddest day of your life and the most freeing day of your life is when you realize that no one cares about you. You know, I think we put so much emphasis on like you said, like, oh, you have to have, you know, people around you and, you know, no one is silent and all that kind of stuff that you kind of forget like, hey, you need to be motivated on your own, you know? And that's what I love about, I think what you've put together at Strides, you know, when you work with somebody or like I've seen, you know, between you and Beaudry, like I think a lot of people look for a business partner that says, hey, I want somebody that's like, you know, all you can pick up all my weaknesses. And what I've noticed about the team you've put together at Strides is it's like anybody at Strides would be super successful on their own, right? Like I don't think there's anything in you, Austin, where you're like, oh, I could do this if I had, you know, this person to do X, Y, and Z. Like, I think you're going to be successful no matter what. And then you put all those people in the same room and it's pretty crazy to see what they can all do, you know? So on that note, I love like the logic and how you broke through that barrier by kind of thinking like, hey, I can either, you know, cry myself to sleep or I can get up and do something about it. Walk us through your door-to-door sales. Cause I think that was kind of the first time that's kind of what got you out of Idaho. That's kind of where you started making money. That's where you started realizing like how good you were at talking to people, right? Was in the door-to-door sales stuff.
Honestly, so I was huge into wrestling, and my wrestling coach at the time, he owned a portion of this company, or I don't know, was involved in this company in some way. And I literally, and it was super funny. So one of my really good friends went and sold with him, paid for his entire like mission, like going out. He had a lot of success. And I was like, well, if he can be successful, I can be successful. But more than that, I know I need to get the heck out of here. And so it was super funny. Like come June, like, and looking back now, it's crazy because recruiting people is super hard. But I legit begged Robert or my coach at the time to get me the heck out of Shelley and put me in a different situation. I went out and I would say I did the just as much as everybody else, maybe worked like a little harder. Long story short, I shit the bed. I did terrible. And it wasn't until the end that I started to see like this, like see it like a piece of success. And it's super funny. So 99% of people after they've failed, I would call that like a failure. Like, yeah, I would learn something about myself, sure. But like all in all, in terms of results, like I had none. And 99% of people would be like, well, throw that out, go find like a different path. And again, this comes back to just like the fuck you mentality of like, no, like I refuse to be bad at anything. I straight up looked at my parents like the next year and I was like, I'm going out again. And they're like, seriously? They're like, why would you go through that again? I was like, I just can't leave like a failure like in my life. Like I need to be successful. And so that's when like the true grind came out. So the typical day of a door-to-door sales rep is you wake up at 9, you have a training at 10, you knock doors from like 11 to 3, take like an hour lunch, and then you knock from, let's say, like 4 to 8. I was completely different. I had taken my own car out. I didn't drive. I literally never had anybody in the car with me. It was like have my meetings, trainings from like 9 to 10, so an hour earlier. So I worked from 10 to probably like 3:30. I would jump in my car, eat lunch for 15 minutes, and I would legit knock until an hour after dark, literally every single day. I literally just made sure that I knocked an hour longer than like everybody else. Like it was intentional. And if you've done door-to-door sales, like that is legit exhausting. And then I would go home. I wouldn't have a conversation. I wouldn't talk to anybody. I would eat lunch, go to bed, wake up, repeat. So I did that for probably like 100 days straight, had a ton of success. and was like, heck yeah, like I crushed it. So I was selling pest control.
How much money can you make in the summer?
So typically when we're recruiting and selling, we say the number between 10 and 15,000. When you're actually like up there, like recruiting, like putting in the work, like I would say it's super realistic to make between like the $30,000 and $60,000 mark in a 3 month period.
And you're making that and you were 18 years old making that.
Yeah. So, 19 years old, I wouldn't say I was making 100,000, but definitely like in the 30 to 60 range or whatever.
Gotcha.
It was just like a huge eye opener for me. And again, it just goes to show, it's like excuses literally get you nowhere. Like there's no point in like whining or complaining or thinking the situation was different. Like 100% like action is the most important thing you have.
That's cool. So you go through, okay. So I think we're starting to put kind of a picture together. We know where you're at now. We've got your college background, your childhood leading into door-to-door sales. And then from door-to-door sales, you go into college. Yeah.
Let me think. So I graduated high school, did door-to-door, went to college, did door-to-door, took a year off, went to coding boot camp, did door-to-door, went back to college.
Okay. So I think we're starting to piece together like who you are and kind of how you operate, right? Like I see kind of this attitude. I see the, how you've kind of harnessed that attitude. And then it really seems like what you picked up as an outside observer of your life, it looks like what you picked up is you kind of picked up this idea that, hey, everybody says things have to be done this certain way. I'm going to do them differently. And I'm going to find, kind of carve my own path to success. So how did you apply that attitude or that worldview to your development? And ultimately, how did that turn into Strides? And I'm actually kind of curious, when you were through with Code Camp or when you were going through Code Camp and you had your first paying client, what was your first paying gig that you took on? And then how long was it before you realized that what you had picked up in door-to-door and in your childhood life about, hey, there's a different way to do things. How long was it before you started applying that to how you built apps?
That's super funny. So actually the very first paying client I had, it was actually like a door-to-door thing. It was super funny. So I was selling solar at the time. What ended up happening was I knocked on this person's door in Utah to sell him solar, and his wife just loved my energy. And I was like, you have to meet my husband. I come back and I start talking with his husband. And long story short, he had like this movement that he was running and he wanted like an app built, and he had like this nonprofit like built up and just was doing a bunch of stuff with it. And I was like, if you buy solar from me, I'll build your app. And so that was the exchange. He bought solar and I built him an app. And everybody's got to hustle, right? And so that was my first paying customer. And so here I am like coding and working on it. And initially I was like, oh, okay, whatever. Like, I don't know, it's your first app. Nobody cares. And I wouldn't say I necessarily, like I learned a ton in terms of development. But I didn't necessarily learn a ton in terms of like running a project, like with a bunch of people. So I built this app, and then I had started working on one more for like a small company in Utah. Ended up getting a gig, and then ended up working at a company, and then starting Strides. And so combining like all of those experiences, like in terms of how I built the foundation or came up with at least the value props that we offer, one of the big things that was not done by a lot of these companies was clear communication and direction for the product, right? It's not as easy as one might think to be able to take somebody's like ideas and execute on them and do it in a way that aligns with like their overall vision. And yeah. So that's really, again, how Strides came to be. There was this huge gap in communication. And it's not just communication of like, hey, what's your idea? But it's like communication on what is your idea? What problem are you trying to solve? Do these things actually like solve the problem? Here's how we're going to execute on it. Like those last two of like, here's like our first iteration on how we think solves the problem, and here's how we're going to build it, weren't done at any company that I worked at. It was just built, we'd bill, and we'd keep working. And I mean, we'd talk with the client maybe like once a month, maybe every 2 weeks. There was a time where I probably didn't talk with the client for 3 months at these companies. And it was just crazy. Like I would say overall, like, I mean, the project went fine, but it definitely could have gone better.
The thing that's interesting to me is I totally get what you're saying about, especially when you're, you know, you're managing a team of overseas developers. And I think when you're a junior on a client, you know, it's easy to look at it and say, man, no one here at the company cares about this client. Like they're just, you know, offloading their tasks, right? They're just trying to get them off their plate and get them to somebody else. And then when you start kind of working with the client, you actually realize that in a lot of cases, the client doesn't even care, right? Like they're just offloading it to you. And it's just easier to say, you know, hey, here's our overseas team, work with them, build something, you know, and then it takes a lot of follow through and a lot of patience to actually like go through things and see why is it not working? Why is it broken? And things like that. And so you've got a really good mind for that, where yeah. I think that's what makes you, you know, a sense, what helps you stand apart, because a lot of people just look at a project and think, oh, if I'm checking off the tasks, that means I'm being productive, right? And I've seen you go in and, you know, destroy an entire task list because you're saying, hey, the way we're doing this is not where we need to be going, you know?
And I rip up processes all the time. What's super interesting, so I am the least patient person in the entire world. If I don't like something, like I'll legit change it like right then and there. Like I go in all the time, and for our teams, I'll go and like reorganize things, say, you know, drop that task, like whatever, here's like our new set of things. And it'll 100% throw our team off, but I don't like to wait. In my head, there is no ideal time to see if something works. And it's super funny. Like the concept of fail fast, fail often is so true. It's like, as business owners, as founders, like there is no 100% right answer. So you might as well do all the shit that you're brainstorming like in a single week and see what worked than to wait a month or two to try something else. Like you might as well break stuff. Like literally, what's the worst that's going to happen? It's super funny. I literally say it all the time. Like if I had a client and they paid me $1 million and I lost it all, I'd love it. Like that would literally be like the best thing in the entire world, because like I got to learn something. Like people need to like not be scared of massive failure. Like I'd love that opportunity.
And it's kind of funny because a lot of people like to read a lot of like self-help books and like learn from authors who have, and Austin freaking hates those books. He will not read any of them. He's just like, cheating. That's like putting a cheat code in. Learn, figure it out yourself. Quit learning from other people.
Funny. Well, it's so funny because it's like, I'll see these LinkedIn posts and they're like, oh, I want to read 52 books a year. And I'm like, oh, you read 52 books a year? Did you execute on a single thing you read? Like, good for you. And it's like, I don't know, like 100% I'm of the execution mentality and not like the, like the only thinking time I need is when I'm showering for 30 minutes each day. Like I'll put a list of things that I want to do or things that don't work and we'll fix it. Literally that's like business. I don't know. And I just don't care to hear other people's stories. Like that's what's also kind of like funny. And I mean, I talked with you. It's like, I think I made like a post today, literally today on LinkedIn, and it's like, people want to hear your story. And I'm like, yeah, it's crazy. People do want to hear your story, but me personally, I don't give a fuck about anybody's story. Like, but that's just me. So
you just want to get it. You just want to get it done.
Oh yeah. Just put in the work.
So Austin, as we're wrapping up, I would be really interested in hearing what advice you would give to somebody. And I want to put them in, I don't want to have you give advice to a potential client or, you know, someone that's thinking about, you know, building their app with you or something like that. I want you to think back to, you know, that kid that is maybe young 20s, you know, sitting in school, doing something maybe they on a path that maybe they don't want to be on, and they have these bigger dreams and these bigger aspirations, and they're maybe afraid to go for it. What advice would you give to that person, or what do you wish you could have told yourself back then? And what would you tell somebody in your same spot now?
One thing that everybody needs to understand is, I mean, I think Gary Vee says it the best, like you're literally just getting started. What you do between your 20s and 30s does not matter. And I literally tell that to my girlfriend all the time. We could go in and this company could totally flop and it wouldn't even matter. Like I could be 30 years old and it just like 100% wouldn't matter. And so the point of it is to get started. Like 100%, like if you're in school and you don't want to be there or you want to try something new, like take that year off, go do something else. You can always go back to school. Those scholarships will always be there. So it's like, take the time to figure out who you are and 100% put in the work. I think those are the two big things, action and reflection. Like if you can really figure those two things out at like a young age, I think you'll be in a pretty good spot.
That's awesome.
Hold on, Shane. We didn't talk about how old Austin is. Can we just, Austin, just here at the end? How old are you?
Nobody needs to know how old I am.
Austin, we need to know.
I'm 35 in a 22-year-old's body.
22.
That is the most accurate thing. So yeah. All I'm saying is, it doesn't matter your age either, right? For those who are listening, literally, this kid at 18 years old decided he wanted something and he executed on it, right? He reflected on what he needed to do and he executed. He did it. And you don't need to be 30 before you can be successful. You don't need to be 25. Like, okay, I'm going to – and it's something that I've always thought, like, okay, I'm going to be super, super successful at this age. No, be successful now. Austin did it. Like, that's just something that's really cool. And he hates telling people – honestly, the only reason why Austin hired me is because I have gray in my beard so that I can look like an older, sophisticated face here. But it comes down to like, listen, go be successful and go be successful now. Don't wait. Yep. You don't need to be. You don't have to be a certain age. Austin's 22. He acts like he's 35, right? That's his choice, right? And that's his maturity level is I want to be successful so nobody's going to get my way. I don't care how old I am.
Well, and it's cool. I think, Austin, that worldview that you've picked up of, hey, I can figure it out and get it done. You know, it's funny. There's a lot of 22-year-olds I wouldn't trust to, you know, drive my car to go get coffee, right? And I've seen people over and over trust you with, you know, $1 million budget or $250,000 budget and never even think to ask, wait, how old are you again? You know, what's your, you know, all that kind of stuff. So it really speaks to your, the worldview you've put together. It's very cool, man.
Go get it.
It's fun.